Hi, this is Dr. Vallesh. Welcome to Pharmacology Simplified. In this video, I'm going to speak about cardioselective beta blockers. This is a very important short topic for your exams, and this will be asked in your theory exam, your viva, and of course in your entrance tests. Before we understand what is the meaning of cardioselective beta blockers, we have to review the locations and functions of various beta adrenergic receptors. Now remember, all beta adrenergic receptors are GPCRs. To be specific, they are GS type of GPCRs. The S stands for stimulation. Okay, so GS type of GPCRs, upon activation by the adrenergic or by the agonist, what is going to happen? It is going to stimulate an enzyme called adenyl cyclase. This adenyl cyclase, as the name itself suggests, is a cyclase. It is going to convert ATP into cyclic AMP. So when agonist binds to GS type of GPCRs, there is increase in CAMP concentration inside the cell. Now, when CAMP concentration increases inside the cell, if it is a cardiac cell, the activity of the cell is going to increase. But if it is a smooth muscle cell, increase in CAMP concentration inside the cell is going to cause relaxation of the smooth muscle. Okay, so this is a very basic, very important concept. Remember that all the various types of beta receptors are GS type of GPCRs, and upon activation, there is increase in CAMP. Remember this. Okay, and there are three major types of beta receptors: beta 1, beta 2, and beta 3. Out of this, beta 1 receptors are located in two important locations. One is the heart, another one is the JG cells of the kidney. Beta 2 receptors are located various smooth muscles and skeletal muscles in the body. Okay, bronchial smooth muscles, uterine smooth muscles, vascular smooth muscles, and bladder wall smooth muscle. Okay, and skeletal muscles, liver and ciliary body epithelium. Beta 3 receptors has just one location, that is the adipocytes. Okay, all these are the locations of beta receptors. Let us look at the functions of beta receptors. Remember that beta receptors, the agonist, the intrinsic agonist, is either noradrenaline or adrenaline, and upon binding, it will lead to all the effects which are responsible, which are required for the fight or flight type of situation. Okay, now when adrenaline binds to beta 1 receptors in the heart, for fight or flight situation, we need the heart to be beating more strongly and more frequently. That is the reason why there is increase in heart rate and force of contraction. When beta 1 receptors in the JG cells of the kidney are activated, it will lead to increase in renin release. Okay, because of that, there is activation of renin angiotensin system, and that will lead to vasoconstriction, leading to increase in blood pressure. Okay, the beta 1 receptors are located in these two important regions. Beta 2 receptors are located in various smooth muscles, and as I told you earlier, beta 1 receptor activation leads to increase in cyclic AMP concentration inside the cell, and because of that, there is relaxation. So whenever adrenaline activates beta 2 receptors, wherever there is smooth muscles, there is going to be relaxation. So bronchial smooth muscles, there is relaxation leading to bronchodilatation. Bronchodilatation leads to increase in oxygen intake, which is required for fight or flight type of response. Next, uterine smooth muscle, there will be relaxation. Vascular smooth muscle, there is relaxation leading to vasodilatation. Okay, and beta 2 receptors are predominantly found in coronaries and skeletal muscles. So vasodilatation happens in coronaries and skeletal muscles, leading to increase in blood supply to the heart, coronaries, and increase in blood supply to the skeletal muscle, so that can fight or flight very efficiently, fight or run away very efficiently. So skeletal muscle activity increases. Bladder wall smooth muscle, wall, not the detrusor. So bladder wall smooth muscle, not the trigone, I'm sorry. So detrusor, beta 2 receptors are located. So upon activation, there is relaxation, so that the urine outflow is reduced, again beneficial when you locate it from the fight or flight type of response. Skeletal muscle as such, beta 2 receptor activation will lead to increase in potassium uptake, and this will cause tremors. So this is responsible for fright, stage fright. Okay, whenever you go on a stage, or whenever you face your about to propose, what is going to happen? You're going to shake. The reason for that is beta 2 receptor mediated increase in potassium uptake into the skeletal muscles, leading to tremors. Next, liver. Beta 2 receptor activation in the liver leads to increase in energy production. There is gluconeogenesis, glycogenolysis, leading to increase in glucose synthesis. Again, this is required for fight or flight type of response. Ciliary body epithelium, it is located on the epithelium beta 2 receptors. Upon activation, there is increase in aqueous humor secretion. Okay. Finally, adipocytes, beta 3 receptors, upon activation, there is lipolysis. So, this is all normal physiological functions of beta receptors. We are speaking about beta blockers. Okay. To be specific, we are speaking about cardioselective beta blockers. So, what is the meaning of cardioselective beta blockers? These are the drugs which block the beta receptors that are located only in the heart. Which type of beta receptors are located only in the heart? It is the beta 1 adrenergic receptors. So, cardioselective beta blockers is another name for beta 1 selective beta blockers. They block only the beta 1 receptors in the heart. They do not block any other beta receptors, not even beta 1 receptors in the kidney, not beta 2 receptors located anywhere in the smooth muscle, in the skeletal muscle, liver, anywhere, not beta 3 receptors which are located in the adipocytes. Okay. So, this is the meaning of cardioselective beta blockers. Now, if this question is asked in your examination, you are expected to write the meaning of cardioselective beta blockers and you are expected to write the advantages and disadvantages of cardioselective beta blockers. This is what we are looking for in your answers. Okay. So, what are the various advantages of cardioselective beta blockers? You can remember that using a beautiful mnemonic ABCDE. A for asthma. Remember that beta 2 receptors are located in the bronchial smooth muscle. Upon activation of beta 2 receptors, there is bronchodilatation. If you block it, beta 2 receptors are blocked in the respiratory tract, what is going to happen? There is going to be bronchoconstriction. This is a disadvantage of non-selective beta blockers. But if you take cardioselective beta blockers, they selectively block beta 1 receptors in the heart. Again, remember the cardioselectivity is only relative. You increase the dose of cardioselective beta blockers, they are also going to block other type of receptors. At therapeutic doses, they are relatively beta 1 selective. Okay, so at therapeutic doses, these drugs do not block the beta 2 receptors in the respiratory tract, and as a result, there is no bronchoconstriction. Hence, these are safer in asthmatics. There is a less chance to produce bronchoconstriction in asthmatics and also in patients who are suffering from COPD. That is for A. B is for blood lipid profile. Cardioselective beta blockers produce no or less deleterious alteration of the blood lipid profile. Okay. In the previous slide, we saw beta 3 receptor upon activation of beta 3 receptors, there is lipolysis. Lipolysis leading to release of free fatty acids. Again, the free fatty acids will be utilized for energy. Okay. Beta receptors blockade will lead to reduction in lipolysis, and that will lead to deleterious alteration of blood lipid profile in such a way that there is increase in LDL cholesterol and decrease in HDL cholesterol. This is harmful. This is if we use non-selective beta blockers. But if we use cardioselective beta blockers, they do not show this effect. So, there is no or less deleterious effect on blood lipid profile. B. Next is C. C is for cold hands and feet. Cold hands and feet is seen when peripheral blood vessels undergo vasoconstriction. So, if you use beta non-selective beta blockers, what do? They block the beta 2 receptors which are located on the vascular smooth muscle. Okay. Blockade of beta 2 receptors on vascular smooth muscles will lead to vasoconstriction, because unopposed action of adrenaline on alpha 1 receptors will lead to vasoconstriction, leading to cold hands, cold feet. This is especially dangerous in patients who are already having Raynaud's syndrome. So, this is not seen when you are using cardioselective beta blockers, because cardioselective beta blockers do not activate or do not block the beta 2 receptors which are located on the vascular smooth muscle. So, C for cold hands and feet. D is for diabetics. So, cardioselective beta blockers are safer in diabetics, because non-selective beta blockers interfere with the carbohydrate metabolism. If you remember in the liver, what is going to happen? Upon activation, there is gluconeogenesis, glycogenolysis. Because of that, there is alteration in the blood glucose levels. Okay. If we use cardioselective beta blockers, it will not interfere with any of these activities, and as a result, it is safer in diabetic patients. So, D for diabetics. less interference with carbohydrate metabolism, less inhibition of glycogenolysis during hypoglycemia. Okay. D for diabetics. E for exercise. If you remember, beta 2 receptors are located on the blood vessels which supply the skeletal muscles. If you are using non-selective beta blockers, there is vasoconstriction because of the beta 2 receptor blockade in the skeletal muscle, blood vessels supplying to the skeletal muscle. There is vasoconstriction leading to decreased blood supply to the skeletal muscles. This will reduce the exercise capacity if you are using non-selective beta blockers. But if you use cardioselective beta blockers, this problem is not seen. So E, exercise capacity, less liable to impair exercise capacity. So this is how you remember the advantages A, B, C, D, E. A, safer in asthmatics. B, less harmful effect on blood lipid profile. C, lower incidence of cold hands and feet, less chance of precipitating Raynaud's syndrome. D, safer in diabetics. And E, less liable to impair exercise capacity. These are all the advantages. But anything that has an advantage also is going to have disadvantage. There are two specific disadvantages of cardioselective beta blockers. These are both TT. First T is tremor. If you remember, propranolol, which is a non-selective beta blocker, is one of the therapeutic options to manage anxiety and anxiety-induced tremor. And that is because it blocks the beta 2 receptors. But cardioselective beta blockers do not block beta 2 receptors. And as a result, cardioselective beta blockers are ineffective in suppressing essential tremor, is ineffective in suppressing tremors due to anxiety. Any type of tremors, they are ineffective. That is the first T. Second T is tachycardia. Now, between hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia, always the dangerous one is hypoglycemia. That is the reason why body has developed certain defense mechanisms to warn itself, warn the person that you are undergoing hypoglycemia, boss, take some sugar. Okay, one of those warning mechanisms is tachycardia. Whenever there is hypoglycemia, there is tachycardia. That tachycardia is mediated by beta 1 receptors. Okay, especially in diabetics, this is extremely important in patients who are having diabetes. So whenever diabetic patients undergo hypoglycemia, there is tachycardia which will suggest to them that there is hypoglycemia. If you use cardioselective beta blockers, this tachycardia in response to hypoglycemia is blocked. Okay, so these are the two disadvantages of cardioselective beta blockers. So five advantages and two disadvantages. If you read this much, we will give you full marks. Okay, in addition to that, you need to remember which are all the cardioselective beta blockers. There is a beautiful mnemonic for this. You might be already knowing this. The mnemonic is this: new beta blockers acting exclusively at myocardium. Okay. N stands for nebivolol. Nebivolol is the most cardioselective beta blocker. This is again asked many times in your entrance exams. Two B's are there. One is bitaxolol, other one is bisoprolol. A, two A's are there. One of them is atenolol, one of the most frequently used beta blockers. E for exclusively, E for esmolol. Esmolol is the ultra short acting beta blocker. You can remember this very easily. Esmolol. Why it is ultra short acting? Because it is metabolized in the blood by plasma esterases. That is the reason why esterases, esmolol. That is the reason why it is ultra short acting. Another A, it is acebutolol. Acebutolol is the one beta blocker which is having all the four special properties due to beta blockers. What are the special properties of beta blockers? One is this, cardioselectivity. Second one is intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. Third one is lipid insolubility. And fourth one is membrane stabilizing property. So all these four special properties of beta blockers is seen with acebutolol. Again, this is an important point for your entrance exams. Next, M, metoprolol. Again, another very popular beta blocker. C for celiprolol. So all these are the cardioselective beta blockers. So I hope I have been able to simplify this topic for you. Namaste. Thank you. Have a nice day.